If you have your Bibles, let's quickly look at 1 John chapter 2, starting at verse number 14. And we'll go to verse number 17. And I'll just say amen if you have it. Just help me, Jesus, if you're still looking. Help me, Jesus, so far. So we all have found 1 John chapter 2, verse 14 through 17. And we'll just launch our lesson. The words of John to the church. how many feel that it's important to know the background of the text before the preacher starts preaching the text? Could you raise your hand? It's important for good understanding of what the text is about. And so let me start by telling you that there is an argument in the church concerning a term or word called gnosticism. And gnosticism is knowledge, and I'm doing this in layman terms, knowledge being the higher good, meaning that the flesh is evil, or matter being the highest good. Flesh is evil, and that there's no way in the world that God or Jesus could have been the Son of God.
Wow.
Because he was in the flesh. And the flesh is evil.
No.
And so therefore, we got it wrong, according to these teachers who came into the church, that somehow we got it wrong, and that they're teaching in the church a new doctrine, saying that Jesus was not the Son of God. He did not come in the flesh. That it is impossible because the flesh is what?
Evil.
Is evil. John hears of this teaching. And as a man of God, he immediately approached the church. He begins to correct the silence.
Yeah, praise God.
Because whether you know it or not, trouble is not new to the church.
Amen.
There have always been men who have rose up and begin to think or feel something different than what have been prophesied by the prophets, confirmed and spoken by the men of God, and have been given to us today. They were challenging the writings of Isaiah, saying that whom have believed our report, and to whom the arm of the Lord is revealed. They were challenging the prophecy. Isaiah 9 and 6, to us a child is born, unto us a child is given. The government shall rest on his shoulders. They were challenging the teaching that Jesus Christ, Emmanuel, would come in the flesh by saying that that's preposterous because the flesh is evil. And if Jesus had came in the flesh, then it would mean that God is part evil and part good. To which John says in John, 1 John chapter 1, that in God there is no darkness. For God is light, and there is no darkness in him at all. He began to remind them, if we're going to have fellowship with him, that we must walk in the light. Is that in your Bible? Y'all look at me like y'all looking at your Bible. I want you to get your Bible. Now that's the danger of quoting scripture, because folks stop looking at the Bible and start looking at you. So let's look at 1 John chapter 1 and verse number 5. I want you to see this very quickly. So I want to read that for me. This is the message that we have received.
We have heard of him.
This is the message we have heard of him.
And we declare
unto you
that God is light.
That God is light.
And in him is no darkness.
And in him there is no darkness at all. In other words, yes, he came in the flesh. There is no darkness in him at all. Read.
If we say that we have fellowship with him. And walk in darkness.
And we walk in this teaching.
We lie.
We're lying.
And do not the truth.
All right, read.
But if we walk in the light. As he is in the light.
We have fellowship one with another.
And the blood of Jesus.
Hold on. The blood of Jesus cleanses us. Amen. Somebody ought to say amen right there.
Amen.
The blood of Jesus cleanses us.
From what?
From all.
All
of our sin. Some of our sin.
Oh.
The blood of Jesus cleanses us from most of our sin.
Oh.
A part of our sin.
Oh.
He said the blood of Jesus Christ Emmanuel. He is God with us.
Amen.
But the thing that we have to understand that John is declaring to them, according to the scriptures, is that you can't, on the one hand, believe that Jesus Christ cleanses us of all sin, but then walk in sin at the same time. Here's the impossibility. It's impossible for you to preach that stuff that you're preaching and say that you're a man of God. It's impossible to live on both sides of the fence. Somebody ought to say amen. For God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. And if we walk in the light, we have fellowship with him. But if I walk in the light and the darkness, I am lying, and the truth is not in me. I want to know if there's anybody here this morning that's trying to walk in the light and the darkness. I want you to know that John says that we're not doing the truth. In fact, it's an impossibility, because we serve a God of standards. We serve a God, an either or God. Matthew 6, verse 24, the Bible says, no man can serve two masters. Either he will love one and he'll hate the other. He'll cleave to one and despise the other. I want you to know you can't be on God's side and the enemy's side. Somebody in here got to make up their mind this morning that I'm choosing Jesus this morning, and this world don't have anything for me. The problem that is existing in the text, there are folks who are listening to the man of God, but then the false teachers, and they're in the middle, and John is saying, you got to make up your mind that God is true and every man is a liar. We serve a God of great standards. God is simply saying, I would that you would be either hot or cold. But since you're neither hot or cold, I will spew you out of my mouth. We serve a God of standards. You can't keep sitting around here looking around talking about I'm a Christian only on Sundays and thank God falling for that stuff. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse number 33, be not conceived, evil communication corrupt good manners. Now I want you to know something right now. When those folk heard John put it on the line and said, either Christ or it's either that you believe those folk in their false teaching, some folk weren't happy to hear that kind of message. I wonder this morning, there's somebody who's listening to this message this morning that said, I don't need to hear that because I'm walking pretty good in the dark, in the light. We have to make up our minds this morning that God is true. And every word that God preaches is true. Everything that God says is true. And God has never lied. He never allowed us to play the middle with him. You remember Amos chapter 3 and verse number 3. The Bible clearly says, how can two walk together except they agree? You either walk with Christ this morning or you're walking with the devil. And if you're mad at somebody, don't be mad at Christ. Don't be mad at me. But you got to look in the mirror and realize that God requires an answer from every man, every boy, every girl, every child in your age of accountability to choose life, to choose Jesus this morning. Culture's argument is the Bible is outdated. Culture's argument is that's an old teaching. I don't want to hear that. Culture's argument is John is just another man. Culture's argument is that I'm my own teacher. John Culture's argument is for that reason that the book is too old to be relevant today. God couldn't have meant what he meant when he talked about the covering in the church. He could not admit what he meant when he talked about the officers or the officers in the church. God couldn't admit what he meant when he talked about marriage in the church. God couldn't admit what he meant. It don't mean the same thing today as it meant when John wrote what he wrote in biblical days. But the Bible says God's word has been settled in heaven. And what God said then, he still means right now. Praise God. Can I preach this a little bit right here? Now, they've been moving from chapter 1 into chapter 2. And so, John recognized he has built spiritual maturity. And he recognized that folk are going to mess up. I'm missing something here. Folk are going to mess up. Folk are going to nice thing. All right. All right. So John recognized that the culture changed. How do you know there's a cultural change in the text? Let's go back to the Bible. In verse number 14, watch your Bible. He said, now I've written unto you fathers, because you've known him from the beginning. That's one culture. Because fathers that knew him from the beginning, that's not a 30-year-old man. He said, because Jesus has died and ascended. He lived to be at least, we know, at least 33 years of age. He said, but you've known him from the beginning. You've known him since the beginning of the gospel. You've known him since taking up time. He's talking about the older man in the church and the leaders of the church. He says, I've been to your fathers, so you know him from the beginning. And he talks to a second generation of people. He says, and the next verse, I've been to you young men. I've been to young men who learned from your fathers about Jesus. I've written on you because you're strong and you abide what? In the word. And then he says, again, I'm going to say it to you again. I've written unto you little children. Now, he classifies three different cultures. What has happened to the church is that we are not the same church that we used to be. When the old man used to be in the church who led his family to the house of God. Well, we're not the same church because men have left the church. And now the young men who don't have a pattern to follow concerning a wholesome spiritual leadership are now leading their family to church sometime, and sometime they don't. Right. They're leading their whole family. And the Bible says, but research says that if a man leads his family religiously or spiritually, 85% of the time, the whole house will come to church. But that's by design, amen. But if the woman comes to church, 85% of the time, only part of the house comes to church. The enemy knows what he's doing. The enemy knows to take out the spiritual leaders of the church, and you can stop the following of the church. And so there is a hatred in this culture toward anybody that identifies himself as a man of God. There is a work that has been done in the movies, that has been done in the culture, who vilify, who points the preacher as somebody that is of peddling money, somebody who's hustling in church, somebody you can't trust. But the old folk used to count on the man of God. Now, how do you think we used to voice our civil rights? We voiced our civil rights through the old men, the religious leaders of the community, Father Time, Martin Luther King. We had some trust in them that they were doing what they were supposed to do, even though they didn't always do what they were supposed to do. But we had faith as a community that they were led to lead us in this direction.
Amen.
But the culture has changed. And so now folk are sitting around and you are nobody. And they'll teach whatever they want to teach, say what they want to say, act any kind of way they want, because that is the way of the world. And so the man of God has to say, I got to talk to some of the old folk in the church. I got to talk to some folk who are still holding on to the word of God. I need to talk to some folk who are raising their children to honor the house of God. I got to talk to them because the world is on a mission. And he begins to write, he begins to suggest, he said, let me tell you something. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. This cultural shift that we're experiencing that does not want to confess Jesus. And the word confess, the kurios, literally means to be his slave, to be his doulos, to be his slave. The kurios, the master, that he has come in the spirit. He said, every spirit that don't do that, certainly not going to receive you. Why? They're not going to receive you because the world now lives out of three sources of power. They live on the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. And you're dealing with a whole other person because they don't even understand how the enemy is taking them out. Their flesh is more than just the meat on their bones. Their flesh is an entity. It is a spiritual entity that's moving. It hungers, it starves, it craves, it demands, it moves. It's got some of you lived in your flesh all your life, and you sit there right now and don't even realize that in your flesh you can't please God. In your flesh you can't please God. Why? Because the Bible says flesh and blood shall not enter the kingdom of God. You need to understand that there's nothing in the flesh that pleases God. And so let me do this if you will. I want to address this if you will in a way you can understand. Sigmund Freud in his structure analyst position, he talked about the id and the ego and the superego. I want you to look at the flesh from the terms that the flesh is this dynamic three, is the id of your spiritual being. It heals that part of you that simply craves stuff and don't even consider if it's good for you. Like a baby, when you want it, you want it. And you even come to the church house, want church to be like you want church to be, and want the preacher to preach what you want to preach, how you want to preach it, and when you want to preach it. Right up in the house of God, that's his culture. And if you ain't preaching what I want to hear, I won't come there, because that's how a baby acts. A baby just wants what he wants. Let me tell you something. A baby don't care if it's 2 o'clock in the morning you sleep.
Amen.
When that baby get ready to eat, that baby want to do what?
Eat.
It wants to eat. So the baby just wakes up. He don't care if you work 12 hours. Give me something to eat. When you just got through eating 2 hours ago. He wants to eat again. He doesn't care about sugar diabetes. He's not thinking about his tooth not coming in right. He's not worried about this. All that it wants to do, all you want is what you want, when you want it, and when I don't get what I wanted, into my ego I go. Amen. Let me show you this. Let me show you the flesh word. Can I show you this? Can I show this in the Bible? And do I got 5 people want to hear this this morning? Watch this. The Bible says, when we look at the flesh, in Romans 7 and verse number 5. I want to start it because Romans 7 verse 5 declares that the sin or the flesh, the motions of sin begins in the flesh. The flesh does not consider, does not even address the mind. The synapses or the memory in the flesh of what it likes does not even consider mentally the consequences of what it's about to do. The preacher that is preaching in the text is not considering the consequences of what he's preaching. He is in his ear. He's in his flesh. And in his flesh, he has determined that he has enough wisdom to challenge God himself. And in challenging God, he's telling God, you're not God. And in his lust of the flesh to appease himself and to be somebody in the text, he's told the whole church that God didn't come in the flesh. Some of us act like God didn't come in the flesh. But the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 6 and verse number 5 that when we are once enlightened by the word of God and a taste of the gift of God, seeing that we crucify the Son of God, it may be, we're unable to repent of our flesh, seeing that we crucify the Son of God all over again. Can I stop by telling you this? Sometimes we live our life as if God didn't die on Calvary's cross for your sins. As long as it feels good, as long as it feels good, as long as it feels good, somebody go ahead, I'm going to say it right here. As long as it feels good, do it. I heard somebody say, as long as it feels good, do it. As long as it feels good, do it. Now hold on a minute. There are two places I need you looking. Y'all walk ahead right quick. I need you looking in your Bible, looking at me. Amen?
Amen.
Look at me, because I'm trying to help folk up in here. I'm trying to teach you. But I got to get your mind on Jesus. You didn't come here for nothing else but Jesus. Isn't that right?
Amen.
So I need you looking in your Bible or looking up here. But I hope you look in your Bible. Because you look in your Bible, the Bible says that he that doeth the will of God, verse number 17, shall endure forever. Culture says, in some places, culture says that there's not even going to be an end of the world, that we're going to come back again and be butterflies or some other type of thing. Culture says that there's just going to be a renewing of things and we're going to be right here on earth. Culture denies the coming of Christ. But the Bible is still right. Am I right about it? The Bible says, I don't care what you feel in your flesh, you need to realize your flesh gonna get you in trouble. And some have lived in our flesh our whole entire life. Look at Romans chapter 7, verse number 18. The Bible says, oh Lord, I know that there is no good thing in me. That is in my what? That's in my what?
Flesh.
I know there is no good thing in my flesh. Now culture says that church is in my flesh. Church is in my heart. But Paul says, oh Lord, I know there is no good thing in me. That is in my flesh. Why? Because when I'm in my flesh, I'm at war with my spirit. Galatians chapter 5, 16, 17 verse, the Bible says that there is a flesh and a spirit, and these two are contrary one to another. That you cannot do the stuff that you would. The reason sometimes you can't praise God like you need to praise God, because you're in the house of God at war with the spirit of God. The wine is going forth. You can't even say amen because you're in your flesh and can't say thank you, Jesus, for what's being said in the house of God. The flesh and the spirit fight against each other. What you want and how you want it has got you in trouble all your life. Anytime you listen to the spirit, flesh
is unpredictable. The flesh, one day, it wants a tall person. The next day, it likes a midget. Then, sometimes it just don't want nobody. We call that bipolarism. Well, you just up there all over the place. No pun to anybody, but hear me when I'm saying this. Your flesh will get you in trouble. And I wonder, as we sit here and we explore the scriptures, for all that is in the world is the lust of the flesh, have we looked at the cravings of man? Man decided to change what God designed in Genesis chapter 3. He says that all in the world are lust of the flesh and the lust of the eye. Notice there is the secret to the craving is the ear, because sometimes the ear and the soul and the ego can agree with one another. They can overlap one another. And it is not a matter of material things or sexual disposition. It's the craving internally that sends you on expeditions to do those things. And it's the craving of the flesh, which is an entity of your dichotomy as a person. And so when we look at the scriptures, we look at psychology, we'll find that when Eve, in Genesis chapter 3 and verse number 6, when she had the lust of the eye. Now notice, the lust of the eye is not on the material things, but it's what's going on inside of her head. In Genesis chapter 3 and verse number 6, the Bible said, when she looked on the tree and saw that the fruit looked good, that's the lust of the eye. What was she lusting inside? She wanted to be like God.
There you go.
See, y'all can spend all this time telling stories about the apple, what kind of fruit you want to call on a tree. It had nothing to do with the tree. It was man's kind, constant attempt to defy God and his word. Amen. God said that the day you eat that tree, you should surely die. The enemy says, now he knows that if you eat that tree, you're going to be like God. She looked at her as a false teaching and thought to herself, that's the tree that God don't want me to eat of, so I feel that things have changed. And I think and I believe that if I take up that tree, it looks good and it smells good, and I think I'm going to bite that tree so I can be my God. Y'all all right? Amen. Y'all all right? You know why we get in trouble sometimes? Because we play like we got. We look at this stuff, and we decide, and God says, don't do this. Solomon, don't mess with that. Solomon goes over there. Why? Because he's defying who? God. It's not really about the women. It's about the be. I'm grown. If you, this, y'all all right? This grown people sermon. If y'all grown right now, raise your hand. But let me tell you something. There's nothing wrong with being grown. But when culture comes in confrontation with the canonicity of the scripture, your grown is either set yourself down somewhere and hear the word of God. Yeah, I've grown you. I'm grown too. I'm grown in life. I'm showing up grown. If you grown in sexy, can you say amen right now? Yeah. And that won't be grown in sexy. But you gotta know when that stuff got to quit. Amen. It's got to stop. If it's not in your house and you don't have a ring on it, you're not supposed to be being grown in sexy. But when nobody but who you with in the. All right, so y'all think I'm melanin.
No.
I'm trying to show you the lust of the eye is the eye, and by definition in the Greek word, it literally means that when John wrote what he wrote, he said that some people look at God with a slanted eye. Has there ever been a scripture that you read that you questioned God while you was reading it? I need two people to tell the truth. Because see, I know it is, but I've heard some of y'all. I heard some of you just flat out challenge God His word and don't even know you challenge Him. Because you so much in your eye, in your flesh, you don't know how against God you are.
Amen.
And it's not so much what you're saying, it's the spirit inside of you that you need to be concerned about. Because the spirit inside of you is challenging God. It's not challenging me, it's not challenging the word. It's because the word is God.
Amen.
And when you look at what God said, if God said, I will send my son born of a virgin, and that the cup will rest on his shoulder, if God says that, God meant it.
Amen.
And when you look at the Bible again and say, well, I don't know if it meant literally born of a virgin, because we know that a virgin can have a baby. Well, that's the man's wisdom. That's man's wisdom. But in your lust of the eye, seeing yourself as God, How many times have we looked at what the Bible says, fret not? The word fret not says, look not at evildoers. How many times we looked at that scripture and said, I don't see why evil folk are always blessed? Uh-huh. We're questioning God to trust God to take care of evil that happens in our life. That these folk ain't this, they not that. Why is God? But that's not your issue. Your issue is that you're looking at into an area and suggesting yourself, maybe God made a mistake. Even in the organization of his church, where God has one church, there are some folk who are looking at the Bible and saying, I can't see God being that narrow-minded and only having one church. Let me tell you something. Who has known the mind of God? And who has been God's counsel? Am I right about it? Who's known the mind? Who are you to question what God said? If God says there's one church, guess what? There's one church. If God says there's one Lord, one baptism, one faith who's above y'all and through y'all, who do you think I think I'm God?
I got to look at it. Y'all all right? No bills like that on here. I got some bills too, but I'm still preaching. If I'm still preaching, you can still get God glory. Y'all all right? Y'all all right? I don't know if I'm helping anybody this morning, but I know one thing. I'm going to show up preaching the word of God. My position, because the lust of the flesh is that a person has replaced the Godhead with their flesh and decided that they'll do whatever craving that they want to. Thus, they have become a god themselves. The lust of the eye is a person who has a perception and now has made his own interpretation that he can decide for himself the thoughts and mind of God outside of the canonicity of the scripture. But what did the Bible say in Isaiah 55, 16, 17? He said, for your thoughts are not my thoughts, nor your